Hello students, so in our previous discussion on the circuit design style, we had discussed the non-clocked circuit designs wherein we had seen how you could implement a given function using static CMOS and we moved on to the ratio logic where you have seen how you could use design an inverter with a resistive load, then depletion load. And then we moved on to designs with pseudo NMOS, wherein you have a function you design with the pseudo NMOS design style. And after that, we moved on to the pass transistor logic style. And so that is the non-clock design style, wherein you don't be using any clock signal. So now we have come to the clock design style, where you have a single synchronizing clock that you use for the design of this circuits. So before moving to the different types of this clocked circuits, we'll see what that is. So static circuits means they are based on certain logic functions and they are based on the static or the steady state behavior of symbol structures, whether that be an NMOS structure or a CMOS structure. So generally the output will be depending on the inputs that we apply, and obviously there will be certain time delay depending on the structure, and it can preserve the output level as long as the power supply is provided. Now we may need a large number of transistors, so that may cause a considerable time delay. So when we had discussed this thing, we had seen that for implementing a single two input NAND gate in the static CMOS implementation, we needed four transistors. So if it's an n bit function, we need 2n transistors. So in high density, high performance digital implementations, wherein we need to reduce the circuit delay and silicon area, we go for dynamic logic circuits. So what is this dynamic logic circuit? So all this operation, the operation of this logic gates depend on temporary storage of charge. Now where do we store a charge? In a node capacitance. So we know that when we look into the MOS structure, we have a lot of parasitic capacitances, and this dynamic logic circuit operation depends on the charge storage in this parasitic node capacitances. So it's unlike in the case of the static CMOS, where everything was based on the steady state circuit behavior. Now this dynamic logic circuit, they require a clock signal, as is obvious from the name, the clocked sequence, clock design style. Now capability of storing, temporarily storing a state or a voltage level. So in our case, it's always 0 and 1, which we call in the voltage level, if we designate, that will be VDD and 0 volt. At a capacitive node allows us to implement very simple sequential circuits with memory functions. So this particular node that's going to store some value, whether that be a 1 or a 0. So it's like we are going to implement circuits with memory, a small memory. Also, the use of the clock signal throughout the system enables us to synchronize the operations of the various blocks that are in the circuit. Now this requires slightly smaller amount of silicon area than the static logic implementation, as you will see from the examples that will be following. So this also requires less power than the static counterpart. Now we'll be moving to the basic principles behind this dynamic circuits. Now consider, so before we move on to what actually this dynamic circuit is or how we can implement a function using dynamic circuit, we'll just go through a D-latch circuit, which is a dynamic one. So consider two inverters, two cascaded inverters, and one NMOS pass transistor, which is driving the input of the primary inverter. So you can see MP is the pass transistor whose input signal is D, and it is also given a gate signal clock or CK, and the output of that pass transistor or the source terminal of that pass transistor is driving the input of the first inverter, and the output of the first inverter is acting as the input to the second inverter. So this is basically a dynamic DRAC circuit. Now this you can see this MP, it's an NMOS pass transistor. So remember all the properties of the pass transistor that we have discussed in our previous module. Remember that whenever we pass a signal through a pass transistor, there will be a signal degradation, whether it be an NMOS pass transistor or a PMOS pass transistor. So NMOS pass transistors, they conduct strong zeros, whereas PMOS transistors conduct strong 1. So when we are trying to pass a 1 through an NMOS, there will be a slight signal degradation which accounts for the threshold voltage of the pass transistor. Okay, so this pass transistor has a clock signal which is designated as CK. Now consider the case when the CK is 1. So the pass transistor is on. So when the pass transistor is on means you can see the CK is high means this pass transistor is on. So that means this D will be passed on to this node. So the voltage Vx here will be equal to D. So if D is high, this Vx will be high, and obviously this capacitance will be charging. Now the other case, when this clock signal is low, when the clock signal is low, obviously this pass transistor, this NMOS pass transistor will be off, and so this node Cx, the capacitance Cx will be isolated from this input D. So there is no current path from the intermediate node X to either VDD or ground. So whatever be the charge that is stored in Cx during the previous cycle, it will be retained there in the Cx. Now this hold operation that we just now discussed, that is during the inactive clock period, this holding of this charge in Cx is accomplished by temporarily storing charge in that parasitic node, capacitance C. Now correct operation of this circuit critically depends on how long sufficient amount of charge can be retained at the node X before the output state changes due to charge leakage. So we'll go into much more details about the charge leakage in the following discussions. Now just understand that when your clock is inactive, when the clock signal is zero, the pass transistor is off, your node Vx or the node X is disconnected from the input D. So it has no path to zero or ground. That means whatever be the charge in the capacitance Cx will have to be retained. Now how long can this charge be retained in the capacitance? Because there are a lot of leakage components going to come up. So slowly this capacitance Cx will start to discharge. So the correct operation of the circuit depends on how long the sufficient amount of charge can be retained by the Cx. So this capacitive intermediate node X is called a soft node. Now this is one example which you can try working out. See, the slides have been prepared in a much elaborate way than that has been described in the syllabus. So certain things we can omit, but it will always add up to the information that we have about all the circuits. So this is an example wherein the values, it's a numerical based example which helps us to understand what we have already discussed theoretically. So a dynamic D-latch, you have the value of VDD to be 5 volt, and the voltage transfer characteristics of the inverters are identical with the specifications are given. The output low, output high, input low, input high values are given. Hope you remember the CMOS inverter voltage transfer characteristics, wherein we have defined what do we mean by the output low, output high, input low and input high, and the noise margins. Now the threshold voltage is also given. So during the active clock phase and the inactive clock phase, what is going to happen? So you can read through that. So again, coming to what we have already discussed, the basic principles of this pass transistor circuits. So actually when we are going into much details about this characteristics of pass transistor is where all this comes useful. All this information comes useful. So the fundamental building block of this NMOS dynamic logic circuit consists of NMOS pass transistor driving the gate of another NMOS transistor, be that an inverter as we have seen in our previous discussion or any other circuit. So we always have a pass transistor driving the input of the subsequent blocks, subsequent transistors in the blocks. Now this pass transistor, as we have seen, it will be having a periodic clock signal, and due to that, or that clock signal is controlling at the turning on and off of that pass transistor. So that decides whether your capacitance Cx will be charging or discharging, or it is charging up or charging down, depending on the input that we apply at the pass transistor's drain. Similarly, the preservation of a correct, so we have seen what are the two possible operations when the clock signal is 1 and what happens when the clock signal is 0. So just recalling that two possible operations when the clock signal is 1 is, so now your pass transistor is on, so you have a logic 1 transfer. Logic 1 transfer means your input is 1. So that means your capacitance will be charged to a high value. Now if you are transferring a logic 0, that means your capacitor will be charging down to a logic low value. So for all these operations, your clock signal has to be 1. Now during the inactive cycle of the clock, what will happen? When the clock is inactive, your node Vx is detached from the input. So the pass transistor is off, your node Vx is detached. So that means the Cx will retain whatever charge it has acquired in this active clock cycle period. So that's about this pass transistors. Now coming to one important concept about this charge storage and charge leakage, we have seen in our previous discussion that the correct operation of the circuit depends on how long this charge can be retained in the capacitance Cx when the clock is 0 or during the inactive clock phase. So the preservation of a correct logic level at the soft node during the inactive clock phase depends on preserving a sufficient amount of charge in Cx despite the leakage currents. So see this situation given here. This is the same circuit. Here you have the clock signal 0, your input is 0. Now you are going to look at what is going to happen to this Cx. So assume that a logic high voltage level has been transferred to the soft node. Soft node means your node Cx, the capacitance Cx, during the active clock phase, and now the input and the clock are 0. So previously your Cx has been charged to the high value VDD or 1 and now your input and the clock are both 0. So slowly your Cx, the charge stored in the Cx, will gradually leak away because of the leakage currents associated with the pass transistor. So we'll see what are the leakage currents that cause this capacitance Cx to leak. Now we look at the cross section of this pass transistor. So you can see you have the drain wherein you have applied the Vin, you have the gate to which you have applied the clock signal, you have the source which you have connected to the node capacitance, where you have identified your node, soft node, your node capacitance, parasitic node capacitance. So you can see both your input and the clock is low, and this is the Cx which is initially charged to VDD. Now the leakage current responsible for draining the soft node capacitance over time has two main components. The subthreshold channel current, you can see from the diagram, the subthreshold channel current, as well as the reverse leakage current in this junction, in this PN junction, the drain substrate junction. So these are the two things that are responsible for the leakage of the charge that is stored in the Cx. Similarly, there is few more components which are not contributing as much as that leakage and the subthreshold, but still they are there. Like the you can consider the drain substrate junction, the CJ. CJ means that's a part of the certain portion of the soft node Cx, which is also due to the reverse bias drain substrate junction. So that is also a function of Vx. Now similarly, this node, this Vx, this soft node, it's going to be connected to some other circuit, some other input, some other gate input. So that also, there also we will be having some capacitance components. So that all will be represented by Cin. So this is how we have to, this is the equivalent circuit that we have to analyze for understanding the charge leakage of the soft node. So this gives us a basic idea how this, even though we say that during the active clock phase we have to retain the charge, but retaining that charge is dependent on all these factors. Now similar to what we have seen just now, that is a pass transistor being used to drive an input signal to other gates, we can also use transmission gates for driving the signal to the input of other gates. See, you can see here in the circuit, you can don't look at the complexity of the circuit. This is one stage where you have stage one, where you have certain function being implemented. This is stage two, which is some other function. Now you can see we are going to supply inputs A, B and C. So this A is supplied to the stage one or the logic block through a transmission gate. Similarly, B is transmitted, passed on through a transmission gate. Similarly, C is also transmitted through a transmission gate. Now, what's the advantage in using a transmission gate over a pass transistor? So, all these things we know, right? The pass transistor signal degradation is there, whereas in the transmission gate, which is a combination of both NMOS and PMOS, even if we are passing a 0 or a 1, we don't have any signal degradation to 0 and 1, because when we pass a 0, you have an NMOS which can pass a strong 0. So 0 will be passed on without any signal degradation. If we are passing a 1, we have a PMOS which can pass a strong 1. So you don't have any signal degradation in the case of 1. So at the output node, you have strong 0 and strong 1 without any signal degradation. So that is the advantage in using a transmission gate to pass on the input signals to the circuits. So you can see here, Vin is, you have this Vin. Vin is passed on to the input of this inverter through a transmission gate, which is controlled by the clock signal. So you can see when the clock is low, you have, when the clock is low, you have this circuit inactive. When the clock is high, you have this transmission gate active, and whatever be the Vin will be passed on to the Vx and ultimately to the next stage wherein we want that. So that this explains that. Now coming to what dynamic logic is. So all the things we have seen, how based on a clock signal we can pass on a signal through a NMOS pass transistor or a transmission gate. Now we'll actually look into some dynamic logic circuits. So dynamic CMOS logic allows to significantly reduce the number of transistors which are used to implement any logic function. So that is the main advantage. If you are using a static CMOS implementation, we will be using 2N transistors to implement a N bit function. Now that is where this dynamic CMOS logic is going to help us. It considerably reduces the number of transistors, as you will see in the following discussion. Now this dynamic CMOS logic operation is basically divided into two phases. First is pre-charging the output node capacitance. Second phase is evaluating the output level according to the implied inputs. So all this two operation is scheduled by a single clock signal. So this drives one NMOS and one PMOS transistor in each dynamic stage. We'll see what this is. Look at the first figure. In this first figure, you can see you have a pull down network. So this pull down network, we know that it is a network which is implemented using NMOS transistors. So you can see the input 1, input 2 and input 3, the 3 input function maybe. So that is applied to this pull down network, which is comprised of this NMOS devices. Now on top you can see a transistor which is designated as MP, which means that it is the pre-charge transistor, and this MP is controlled by the gate signal phi, which is a clock signal. That same phi is controlling another transistor ME, which is the transistor used in the evaluation phase. Now this phi controls both the pre-charge phase transistor and the evaluation transistor. Now how this works? When the clock signal phi is low, what happens? When the clock signal phi is low, this being a PMOS and this being an NMOS, which transistor will be on? When phi is 0, your MP will turn on. When MP is on, this output node will be charged, or this output capacitance CL will be charged to PDD, right? So that is what we call the pre-charge phase. The pre-charge phase. Now the second phase, the clock signal turns high. So when the clock signal is high, your PMOS transistor MP is off, your NMOS transistor ME turns on. So your output node, the CL, is charged to VDD. Now you have this ME turned on. So depending on this pull down network, you have the CL either remaining at VDD or discharging to 0 through this pull down network and ME. So it all depends now on the inputs. If the inputs 1, 2, 3 are such that this pull down network is switched on, so you have PDN on and ME on due to the high clock signal. So you have this pull down, this complete path to ground. So your CL will discharge to ground. Suppose if this inputs are such that this pull down network is not on, it is off. So even if your ME is on, your capacitance CL cannot discharge to ground. So what happens? The CL retains the previous value. And what is that? It is the high value due to the pre-charge. So this is the two-phase operation of a dynamic logic. So whatever function you are implementing, you have to implement inside this pull-down network. If it's a two-input NAND function, how will you do? You connect two NMOS transistors in series. So that is your pull-down network. So two NMOS transistors plus one evaluation transistor plus one pre-charge transistor. So that will be how you draw a dynamic logic circuit, a function using dynamic logic circuit. Okay. Now this second circuit, so commonly we'll be using this first circuit wherein you design the pull down network with the NMOS devices. Now the second circuit is actually a 5P network. We'll be using that sometime later into this discussion. So this 5P network is actually where you use a pull-up network. So remember, pull-up network means it is comprised of PMOS transistors. So here the only difference is, here also you have the evaluation transistor and the pre-charge transistor, but the order is changed. See, here the pre-charge, or here in the 5P in this network, we call that as pre-discharge. So when the clock signal is high, your NMOS device is on and your output node capacitance is discharged to 0. So that is pre-discharge. And when the clock signal is low, your ME, the evaluation transistor, which is a PMOS in this case, it is on, and you have this pull-up network which depends on the input signals. So depending on the condition of pull-up networks and ME, your output will be pulled up to 1 or it will retain at the pre-discharge state of zero. So that is the two kind of network, and whenever in the you are given a logic function and asked to implement that with dynamic logic, you simply follow this NMOS style, wherein you use the NMOS devices in the pull down network, as we have seen with the static CMOS, wherein NMOS in series and function means NMOS in series, or function means NMOS in parallel. Okay, now here this dynamic CMOS, you the certain advantages of this is given. One thing is that, one major thing is that you won't have any static participation, because either when the clock is high, when the clock is high, your pre-charge phase will be there, so your output will be pulled up to high value. It does not have any connection to the ground. Now when the clock is low, when the clock is high, your evaluation phase is active. That means the output node will be pulled down depending on your inputs. So at any time there won't be a static power dissipation. Okay, so this is an example of a 4 input NAND gate. You can see 4 input NAND gate means you have 4 NMOS transistors connected in series with in1, in2, in3 and in4 as inputs, and you have the pre-charge transistor which is a PMOS connecting VDD and output, and you have an evaluation transistor which is an NMOS connecting this pull down network comprising of this 4 transistors in series with the ground, and both evaluation transistor and the pre-charge transistor are controlled by the clock signal 5. Now this is an example of a function being implemented with the dynamic CMOS. So this is how your questions are gonna come. You will be given a function and you will be asked to implement the function with static CMOS, dynamic CMOS, pseudo NMOS. So different function, different circuit styles, you have to implement the given function. So this given function, look at this, it is A1, A2, A3 plus B1, B2 the whole bar. So you want a complement of the function. So you just look at the function, it is A1, A2, A3. So you have three NMOS devices in series with inputs A1, A2 and A3. Okay. Now you have B1 and B2. So you have two NMOS devices B1 and B2 in series. Now it's a OR function, A1, A2, A3 or B1, B2. So you are connecting them in parallel, the two series branches in parallel. Now this constitutes your pull down network. Now what else do we want? We want the pre-charge transistor which is a PMOS MP, we want an evaluation transistor which is ME, and those two transistors controlled by the common clock signal, and the junction of the pre-charge transistor and the NMOS block, you have the output node. Okay, now look at this waveform. You have the clock signal, your clock is high, consider the situation when the clock is low. When the clock is low, which phase is active? Pre-charge phase. So pre-charge means your PMOS transistor MP will be on, your output will be pulled up to high after a small delay, a gate delay. Then when the clock signal is high, what happens? MP turns off, ME turns on, and depending on this inputs, your output will be pulled down or kept in the high state. So if A1, A2 and A3 are high, what happens? You have a path for Vout to discharge to ground through this path, right? Or if B1 and B2 are high, you have another path. So that's how this implementation works. So this explains that. Now what are the limitations of this dynamic CMOS logic? Fundamental limitation for the practical multi-stage applications. So the issue comes when you are going to cascade two dynamic structures. So you have one dynamic structure with here shown as first with the spool up network, first pull down network, first stage and most logic. So this is first stage and this is the second stage. Okay, this is another stage. So this first stage, the output of this first stage, which is written as V out 1, is given as input of this second stage. Okay, output of this first stage dynamic CMOS logic is given as input of this second stage. That means the output is given as the input to some circuit in the NMOS stage, in the second stage of this cascode structure. So what's the issue here? So here also we have this for both the stages you have the precharge transistors, you have the evaluation transistors, all controlled with the same clock signal phi. Now when phi is low, what happens? When phi is low, both this precharge transistors are on, Vout1 and Vout2 will be turned to high value, as you can see from this waveform. Now the clock signal becomes high, so that means we know that it has to go now to the evaluation phase. So now the evaluation stage happens. Now look what happens in the evaluation stage. Your clock signal is high, that means your evaluation transistor and this evaluation transistor are both on. So depending on what are the inputs to this NMOS logic here and here, your output nodes V out 1 and V out 2 can either discharge to ground or it can retain its previous high value. Now see in this figure, this somehow your first stage, this first dynamic stage, the inputs are such that when the evaluation happens, this stage, all these inputs are high, your NMOS logic is high, your evaluation transistor is high, so this V out should discharge to zero, should become zero. So that means when V out is zero, that zero is going to the input of the second stage. That means this transistor, this NMOS is off. So even if this is one, this transistor input is one, and this evaluation transistor is on, V out 2 cannot discharge to ground. So V out 2 will remain at high value. But what happens is immediately when the clock signal becomes high, this V out 1 and V out 2 simultaneously, all these calculations are happening. So this NMOS logic, the inputs are applied to this NMOS logic and this NMOS logic is on. At the same time, this V out 1, it has been precharged to 1, right? So that 1 goes into this input. So the second input also is 1 here. So 1 and 1, this also turns on. So V out 1 also drops to 0. V out 1 also drops to 0, V out 2 also drops to 0, whereas V out 2 should have remained at 0 value. So this is the issue. So V out 1 and V out 2 calculation happened simultaneously, and this V out 1 immediately after the precharge, when the evaluation happens, immediately this V out 1 is given to this input and this whole block becomes on, and this also being on, V out 2 is pulled to ground. Whereas V out 1, if there was slight delay, V out 1 would have already become 1 through this on path, and this would not have happened. So this is an erroneous condition. So, although the first stage output assumes the correct value once the stored charge is drained, that means output 1 being pulled down to 0, the correction of the second stage output is not possible. So, that becomes an error. So that means you cannot cascade dynamic CMOS logic stages driven by the same clock signal. So if they are both driven by the same clock signal, you cannot cascade the two dynamic logic CMOS. So this is a very great disadvantage of this dynamic CMOS structure. So even though we say that it has got lot of advantages like low power dissipation, low transistor count, large noise margin, this one severe limitation restricts the use of dynamic CMOS logic in many applications. So what's the disadvantage? The dynamic CMOS logic states driven by the same clock signal cannot be cascaded directly. So we have developed certain clocking schemes and circuit structures to overcome this problem. So all this comes under us next topic, which is called the high performance dynamic CMOS circuit techniques, that we'll discuss. But before going to that, there is one important thing that has to be discussed, that is called the monotonicity requirement. That is, when a dynamic circuit is in evaluation, the inputs must be monotonically rising. That means your input can be low, input can start low, it can remain low. That is, your input is zero during the before the evaluation, and during the evaluation it can remain low. Similarly, your input can start low, it can rise high. Your input is zero before the evaluation, and when the evaluation starts, your input goes to high. Similarly, your input can start high and remain high, but it cannot start high and fall low. See what happens. Look at the signal A, 5, and output Y. So your 5 is the clock signal. You can see when 5 is 0, the precharge happens. Precharge happens means whatever be the input A, your output will be high, because during the precharge, the input does not have any control over your output signal. Your precharge transistor precharges the output node to high. So your output node is now 1. Now clock goes high. Clock goes high means evaluation starts. Now during the evaluation, starting of this evaluation, your input was high. Input was high means your NMOS block is on, your evaluation transistor is on. So your output will be pulled down to 0. Your output is pulled down to 0. You can see that here, your output being pulled down to 0. Right, but what happens after some time, your input is going down. So still in the evaluation, mid of the evaluation, input is going down. That means your output, when input is going down, means your NMOS logic now is off. That means there is no discharge path for this output node to ground, but your output cannot rise. It remains in that zero state. So an error happens. Even though your input is zero, your NMOS block is off, but still your output cannot rise to the high value. It remains at its zero value, which is the output of the previous input, right? So this is due to the input starting high at the start of the evaluation phase and going low at the mid of the evaluation phase. So this is what we call the monotonicity requirement. This should not happen. Monotonicity violation during the evaluation will lead to erroneous output. So the inputs must be monotonically rising for the dynamic gate to compute the current function. Now, because this monotonically falling output X is not suitable input to a second dynamic gate expecting monotonically rising signals. So when we are cascading two dynamic stages, we always want rising signals at the inputs. That is, we want a 0 to 1 transition at the input, not a 1 to 0 signal. Okay, so that means the dynamic gates sharing the same clock cannot be directly connected. Now we have some other logic with which we overcome this shortcoming, this limitation of the dynamic logic. So we'll discuss this high performance dynamic circuits in our next section.